Hi everyone, hope you are doing good. Today we will discuss about the osteology of mandible. As we have seen in the previous videos of Introduction to Skull, mandible is a part of facial skeleton, and we will discuss about the mandible under following headings. We will see introduction, presenting parts, features, attachments, ossification and fracture. As you know, the mandible is the largest and strongest bone of the face. It's an unpaired bone, only movable bone apart from ossicles. It forms the lower jaw. It is cartilaginous in origin because it is derived from Meckel's cartilage. And during development, it has two halves which are united at the symphysmenti. It is L-shaped in the lateral view, and it presents a U-shaped body, or you can say horseshoe-shaped body, and two oblong rami coming from the posterior superior part of the body there. You can see rami on either side and a midline U-shaped body in front of those rami. And when you see the features, the body has external and internal surfaces, superior and inferior borders. You can see that is the extent of the body. You can see it has the internal surface. This is the internal surface, and this is the external surface. The superior border also called as alveolar border. Inferior border is also called as base. That is the base of the body of the mandible. Alveolar border has sockets for the articulation with the teeth. That is gomphosis. And in the midline, the body presents a mental protuberance, a triangular protuberance at the symphysis menti, and on either side of the protuberance you will see mental tubercle on either side, and on either side of the protuberance you will see incisive fossa with the origin of mentalis muscle, and along the upper border of the midline of the body you will see orbicularis oris, and on either side you will see mental foramina between superior and inferior borders of the body of the mandible. Mental foramen transmits mental vessels and mental nerve, which are continuation of the inferior alveolar structures, and an oblique line extending from lower border to upper border below the mental foramina, giving attachment to three structures. In the anterior part, you will see depressor labiae inferioris, depressor anguli oris, and in the posterior part, it gives origin to some fibers of buccinator. So, oblique line gives attachment to three structures, and just below the oblique line, you will see attachment of platysma muscle, and at junction with the ramus, you will see the facial vessels course there, just to the anterior border of the masseter muscle in a clinched position. You can see there facial vessels running there, junction between the body and ramus. So the external surface shows mental protuberance, mental tubercle, incisive fossa, mental foramina. Oblique line with the three attachments: depressor labiae inferioris, depressor anguli oris, buccinator, and you will see platysma and facial vessels. You can see all the structures here. We have isolated some features here. That is the mentalis muscle coming from the incisive fossa on either side of mental protuberance. That is orbicularis oris attached to the near the superior border, just above mental protuberance. You can see depressor labiae inferioris in the anterior part of the first half of oblique line. In the posterior part of the this one, you will see depressor anguli oris along the just below the oblique line. You will see platysma, and in the posterior part where the body meets the ramus, you will see course of facial vessels. The facial artery enters the face just in front of the anteroinferior angle of the masseter. And in the posterior part of the oblique line, you will see buccinator muscle. So these are some attachments there, you can see, and also you will see marginal mandibular nerve of the facial nerve and mental foramina. It is a paramedian foramina, just like supraorbital and infraorbital. It's paramedian in position, transmitting mental artery, vein, and nerve, which are continuation of inferior alveolar nerve and vessels in the lower jaw through the mandibular canal. Mandibular canal is present in the ramus, that we will see later. Coming to the inner surface of the body, just like the outer surface, the inner surface also shows an oblique line. which is called as myelohyoid line. From there, anterior part of the lower border to the posterior part of the upper border, oblique myelohyoid line, because myelohyoid muscle takes origin from there. Above you will see sublingual fossa, below submandibular fossa for the lodgement of respective glands. So this oblique line divides into two fossas, upper smooth fossa and lower deep concave fossa. Upper smooth fossa for sublingual gland, lower concave fossa for submandibular. And you can see from the myelohyoid line, you will see myelohyoid muscle, each half coming from one side, that is sublingual gland, fossa for sublingual gland, and here fossa for submandibular. As we have discussed, in the submandibular gland, the submandibular gland will hook around the posterior free margin. You can see the lateral surface of the large superficial part is related to the submandibular fossa, and you can see how the myelohyoid muscle is forming an anterior median raphe there, forming the roof of the submental triangle. So you can see the myelohyoid muscle is dividing the inner surface into sublingual and submandibular fossa, and just near the myelohyoid line you will see the myelohyoid neurovascular bundle there, myelohyoid vessels and nerve to myelohyoid. Myelohyoid vessels are branches of inferior alveolar vessels. You can see now, that is the mandibular canal or foramina transmitting inferior alveolar nerve. Just before the inferior alveolar vessels enter mandibular foramina, they give this myelohyoid artery and myelohyoid vein, and just below them you will see nerve to myelohyoid, that is nerve to myelohyoid, and in front of them, just below third molar tooth, you will see lingual nerve. So lingual nerve is also related to the body of the mandible on the inner surface, just below the third molar tooth, and this is very important. This relation is important in giving lingual nerve blocks during surgeries on the floor of the oral cavity, because lingual nerve forms the general sensation of the anterior two-third of the tongue and the floor of the mouth. You can see, and lingual nerve hooks around the submandibular duct, that is nerve to myelohyoid, myelohyoid vein, and myelohyoid artery, how they are related. And you can also see the loop of facial artery just behind the submandibular gland. So this is how the myelohyoid line is important. And one more thing, just behind the third molar tooth, you will see pterygomandibular raphe. We have discussed about it, this in norma basalis. Pterygomandibular raphe extends from the medial triggered plate, lower end of medial triggered plate, that is triggered hamulus. You can see now, it is giving origin to the buccinator in front and the superior constrictor behind. You can see pterygoid hamulus there, pterygomandibular raphe. So that is there, and just on the inner surface of the symphysis menti, behind the symphysis menti, you will see two tubercles, superior genial tubercle, inferior for geniohyoid muscle, and superior for genioglossus. Genioglossus forms the root of the tongue. Geniohyoid extends from this inferior genial tubercle to the hyoid bone, and along the inferior border of the body, there is attachment of investing layer of deep cervical fascia. And just near the symphysis menti, you will see digastric fossa for the origin of this anterior belly of digastric. On either side, you will see digastric fossa, just below and in front of sublingual fossa. You can see along the entire inferior border, you will see investing layer of deep cervical fascia. And just behind the symphysis menti, below inferior genial tubercle, you will see the digastric fossa. Coming to the ramus of the mandible, it presents two surfaces, lateral and medial, or you can say outer and inner, and four borders, that is superior border with two processes and a notch, posterior, inferior, and anterior. Anterior border fuses with the posterior part of the body of the mandible. You can see the outer surface and inner surface. Medial surface, in the midline, in the middle, it presents a mandibular canal or foramina. That is the outline of the ramus, four borders and two surfaces. The lateral surface is overlapped by the parotid gland, that you have seen in the relations of parotid gland. You can see the posterior border there, anterior border. The superior border presents a coronoid process there, and a notch, mandibular notch, and a condylar process behind. with the head and neck of the mandible, which articulates with the squamous preftemporal bone to form temporomandibular joint. The lateral surface is related to the masseter muscle, which is attached here, and you can see some bony ridges on the outer surface or lateral surface of the ramus for the insertion of the masseter muscle. And on the inner surface, you will see a mandibular canal there, foramina, which will continue as canal, transmitting inferior alveolar vessels and nerves. Inferior alveolar vessels are branches of maxillary artery. Inferior alveolar artery is a branch of first part of maxillary artery, whereas inferior alveolar nerve is a mixed branch coming from the posterior division of mandibular nerve. Before they enter, they give myelohyoid vessels. Coronal process is there, giving attachment to tendon of temporalis and a mandibular notch, transmitting mesenteric nerves and vessels. That is condylar process with the head and neck and pterygoid fovea. The head is elliptical, forms a temporomandibular joint that we discussed in the temporomandibular joint. Please go and see that video. So the head of the this condylar process gives attachment to capsule, lateral temporomandibular ligament. You can see pterygoid fovea there for the insertion of lateral pterygoid muscle. Lateral pterygoid will continue as the articular disc. So these are the things you see in the superior border. There, that is the head giving attachment to the capsule, lateral temporomandibular ligament behind. Posterior border is related to the stylomandibular ligament and pituitary gland. Anterior border there, junction with the body, is related to facial vessels. And also some part of the anterior border gives attachment to tendon of temporalis. You can see here, the lateral surface is giving attachment to masseter, superficial and deep fibers. And as you come to the medial surface here, medial surface is giving attachment to medial pterygoid here, below and behind the mandibular foramina. Near the angle, there is insertion of medial pterygoid and this mandibular foramina transmitting inferior alveolar nerve and vessels. This side you can see, on the right side you are appreciating the canal there or foramina. You can see inferior alveolar nerve, branch of posterior division of mandibular nerve. And these vessels, myelohyoid vessels, you can see that we have already discussed in the inner surface of the body. Then you can see the tendon of temporalis attached to the coronoid process and also to the anterior border of the ramus. And you can see lateral pterygoid inserting into the pterygoid fovea along the superior border. So these are the arrangements you can see, and you can see mandibular notch there. Mandibular notch is transmitting this masseteric nerve and vessels. Masseteric artery is a branch of second part of maxillary artery. Masseteric nerve is a branch of anterior division of mandibular nerve. And this mandible develops within the cartilage. It has age changes. The angle of mandible is around 110 to 115 degree, obtuse in younger age. And the mandibular, this mental foramina is nearer the lower border in old age, and mandible is prone for all kinds of fracture, simple, compound and comminuted. And these are different sites of mandibular fracture, and according to studies, most common part of the mandible to be involved is the body, unilateral, bilateral, multiple and comminuted. Reasons for the fracture are road traffic accidents, interpersonal violence, contacts. So body of the mandible is commonly involved in the fracture. Sometimes neck of the one side and body of the other side may be involved. The immobilization is done through the compression plates, small plates, mini plates and screws. And depending upon the type of fracture, we may go for closed reduction, where it is reduced by not opening skin and mucosa. You can see the plates and screws here. And if it is open, by tearing the skin and mucosa, you can go for the manipulation of the fracture, that is open reduction. So in case of non-union also, these can be done, this open reduction and rigid fixation. So this is about the mandible. Learning never stops. Take care.